The RoxAnne Tauriello Show takes you inside prison and jails as men reveal lives of sin and consequences. Hear God's amazing message of hope. Listen to the testimony of the infamous David Berkowitz and celebrities like Jerome Hines and Melba Moore, to athletes Marvis Frazier and Charles Wade, to Dr. D. James Kennedy and Joe Douglas. The RoxAnne Tauriello Show, where you'll find out how to receive from God forgiveness, a brand new life, and eternal life.
Greetings, I'm RoxAnne Tauriello, and welcome. Joining us today is Charles Way, starting fullback with the New York Giants, and we'll be talking about pro football, his life behind the scenes, and what he personally thinks about the Bible and Jesus Christ as his own Lord and Savior. And we'll be right back with Charles Way of the New York Giants.
The RoxAnne Tauriello Show takes you inside prison and jails as men reveal lives of sin and consequences. Hear God's amazing message of hope. Listen to the testimony of the infamous David Berkowitz and celebrities like Jerome Hines and Melba Moore, to athletes Marvis Frazier and Charles Wade, to Dr. D. James Kennedy and Joe Douglas. The RoxAnne Tauriello Show, where you'll find out how to receive from God forgiveness, a brand new life, and eternal life.
Welcome back, and joining me today is Charles Way of the New York Giants. Welcome, Charles.
Thank you. I'm happy to be here.
Thank you so much. Before we talk about pro football, let's talk a little bit about your childhood and your family. You were born in 1972 in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. You have one brother named Cleveland. And tell us a little bit about what Charles Way was like growing up.
Well, you know, I was shy.
I was a mama's boy,
if you could say. You know, I always stuck by my mom, and I guess I never wanted to leave her side. People, they had like stories about I was pretty spoiled because of my mom. You know, it would rain, and my aunt would have to come pick me up from daycare, and I wouldn't want to. I had on my rain boots and everything, and I wouldn't want to even step on the ground because it was wet. So I was pretty spoiled, but
spoiled and very loved, very much so.
Yeah.
Now, you were brought up in a Christ-centered home.
Yeah,
parents,
you know,
Christians, born again Christians.
How my mom and dad got into the church that we go to now, attend now in Philadelphia, is I went to daycare center there.
Mm-hmm. Actually, even the nursery,
yeah,
I believe.
I was brought to the nursery. And that's how my mom got into the church, and she started going, and that's how my dad started going.
So you went from the nursery to the pew.
Right. You might just say that. I was born in the church.
Born in the church. Parents read the Bible to you?
Yeah. I went to my mom made sure I went to Sunday school every Sunday, and you know, went to vacation Bible school in the summertime.
Learned so, about heaven and hell.
Yeah. So
Christ
I, so you know, I grew up, and I pretty much knew Jesus Christ when I was growing up, and I didn't accept him into my life until I was 8.
Now at 8 years of age, you realized already that through the Word of God, that even though you were a child, that you had sinned and a desire to turn from sin, and you made Jesus Christ
my Lord and Savior.
Your Lord and Savior at a young and tender age. How old were you when you really got interested in sports?
I was always interested in sports. My dad had season tickets for the Philadelphia Eagles games for the longest time, and I wasn't about 7 or 8 years old until they started taking me to the games, because my brother and him used to always go.
Yeah.
So once my brother got older and started, you know, just hanging out more often with the guys, he let me go to the games that weren't important. So I started to go, me and my other friend, and that's how we got into it. And my dream was always to play professional football ever since
on
I was
the
little
Giants?
Kid. Well, I was Eagles fan. So.
Now, as a youngster, was there a time, a certain occasion, time, when you said, you know, I really want to be a pro football player. I'm really good at this. Was there ever a time that you look back and you can remember something like that?
You know, I never always wanted to. That's a dream.
It was a dream.
But you don't, if you stay focused too much on that, you lose sight of all the other things mm-hmm. around you. And I had my schooling. My parents always told me, hey, football isn't going to be around forever. You need something to fall back mm-hmm. on. And that's what I focused my schoolwork and tried to get my degree and went on ahead to get a civil engineering degree at the University
Wonderful.
Of Virginia.
Wonderful.
And you know, God willing, he'll further my endeavors.
Mm-hmm. And during your high school years, what was happening in your family's life to cause you to lean on the Lord even more?
You know, well, that was a part of my life where, you know, I really needed the Lord. And, mm-hmm. I'm glad my relationship with him was close. I was mm-hmm. close to him, and I knew I needed to lean on him because, you know, coming in high school, my brother just got out of college, and he just starting to finish college and mm-hmm. start to find a job. And, you know, in college, there's a whole lot of temptations in college. You got mm-hmm. women,
Precious.
Drugs, liquor. And unfortunately, he, you know, Satan tempted him with mm-hmm. drugs. And, you know, we both were born in the church, you could say. He went to the same church, mm-hmm. you know, and he was a junior deacon at our church. And so he was in the church. Mm-hmm. But, you know, Satan is always trying to steal God's children.
The Bible says yeah. that Satan walks around.
Looking for, you know, looking
like
for God.
Yeah,
looking
right.
for God's children, just waiting for you to snatch you up. And, you know, he found the right time, and he lured him away. And some nights he wouldn't even come home until the morning. You worry and you wonder, well, what's going to happen? Is he dead or, you know? And that's mm-hmm. when I just kept getting on my knees at night saying, Lord, I know you have a plan for all of us. Mm-hmm. And maybe this is your way to say, hey, come back to me. I'm the one that you're supposed to be following.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what he does to all of us. When we're straying too far away from you, he'll try to smack you or spank you like your father and bring you back. And he does it longer for others.
That's why we need the Spirit of God dwelling in us and obedient to the Spirit of God that enables us to overcome temptations, drugs, and things of this nature. Bible says with God all things are possible. Whether a person is a drug addict, as you know, an alcoholic, God can deliver them and give them victory over these things. But it was a time in your life when you actually were able to draw closer to God.
How many of us would die for some random person on the street? Now, there's a story that everybody, that George McGovern, our chaplain, tells, and that, you know, it's a drawbridge operator, and he brought his kid to work. And it's his job, his duty, to make sure the train passes over the bridge and make sure that drawbridge is lowered every time the train is about to come. But his kid was playing underneath the drawbridge and in the gear shafts, and he got stuck, and the train was coming. So it was either him closing the drawbridge and crushing his kid to death, or killing 200 people. Mm-hmm. So he made the decision that, hey, I want to save these people. While the train passes, people are waving at him. And they don't know what just happened to his son, but they're waving and he's crying. How many people would do that? I don't know too many. I would have to shudder to think if I could do something like that for people I didn't even know. So that, you know, God is a loving God, and you just trust in his word that everything will come out all right. Mm-hmm. And I always tell people, and when I talk to kids, you know, you keep Jesus Christ number one in your life, and you'll never come in second.